We should have been better at taking photos and doing that stuff during the 90s, but we didn't.
Hey everyone, welcome to the channel. I'm Belgian Jasper. If this is your first time on the channel, hit subscribe right now. Legendary Norse heavy metal band EINHERJER is back with maybe their best album in their 25-year career. And on top of this release, their classic debut album is being re-released. More than enough reasons to sit down with bandleader Frode to talk all about the new album and the re-release.
Years going strong now. There's a lot of energy. There's a lot of power. Does that also mean that even for somebody so experienced as yourself, this is still an excitable event for you to launch an album? Or is this, you know, 25 years, seen, you know, we've seen it all, we've done it before, another album, who cares?
I think still after 25 plus years, I think it's still, you know, releasing an album is actually a pretty big deal. There are loads of excitement within the band, absolutely. Still, after all these years, I find it very exciting to release an album. Yeah.
I mean, when the first press updates came out, one of the things that was mentioned was, you know, the band is going for a raw production. But when I got a chance to listen to the album in full, one of the first things that hit me was how solid and how good the production actually sounds. And I mean, I like the extra touches, like for example, the hammer in the Blood and the Iron that we hear, and throughout the album, there's more things like that. But one of the very prominent elements in the music, more than ever maybe before, is your bass really powering the sound. Is that something that just naturally evolved, or was that something that going into recording you wanted to make sure that the glue that the bass can be in a sound had to be front and center?
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank you for the giving compliments regarding the production, because I produced it myself and I recorded it and mixed it myself. So yeah, when it comes to the bass, I mean, honestly, I've been a guitarist for 30 something years, and I've also played bass longer than I played guitar. But I think bass is the coolest instrument out there, and when you have a really powerful, really cool bass riff, you should let that shine, you know. And for the last few albums, I think it might be, you know, a little bit of a coincidental, but approximately from the time I took over the bass as the main instrument,
in the production,
I might also, you know, give a bit more focus on the albums, because the last two albums I mixed myself, and the bass, yes, it might be a bit loud, but I think it. I think it's kind of good loud. It's a balanced loud. So it has a meaning, you know. It kind of adds to the overall sound, and it makes it all sound a bit more badass, I think. Yeah.
More than one bass player has told me that a bass guitar is really just a guitar for adults. I don't know if you agree with that.
That's a good one, yeah.
But has that been at times challenging for you? Is that still challenging when, you know, playing some of the classic older songs that you used to play on guitar that now you're playing on bass for live shows?
No, not really. I mean, playing bass, it's a... I feel it kind of comes more natural to do that, especially when you're singing, because maybe you're not playing that many notes as you are when you're playing the guitar, so it's easier to kind of focus, you know, multitask when you're doing bass. And I think the importance of bass, kind of, you know, it goes back to the bands you were listening to when you grew up, you know, like, you know, Metallica with Cliff, and, you know, Maiden, you know, Steve Harris and stuff, and it's very, very prominent, very important bass players. And I think that those guys kind of, you know, influenced you a lot, and are still coloring, you know, the way you are looking at heavy metal. So I think it's finally, finally for us, so to speak, you know, that we get the proper focus on bass.
Okay. Talking about, you know, that need to find direction and to find your purpose. Not only is that the, not only does that explain the evolution of the band, but it seems to be the main themes of the new album as well. For if you look at the lyrics, can you talk a little bit more about that? I mean, the album was written during the COVID pandemic already. If I
The music was written prior to the pandemic, but all of the lyrics were written, you know, post. Or during. So yes, of course, it has had its influence on the lyrics, maybe more than we'd like to think, because it's not none of the songs, maybe except one, are like actually about this stuff. But I think your whole frame of mind, your mental place is kind of, you know, colored by the situation the whole world is in, you know. And but for everything, the music, everything was written prior, but then again, you know, when it comes to the whole title and the whole thing, I think everything fits kind of perfect with the whole pandemic and everything that's going on now, because we're the title is kind of based upon, you know, we are always, the thought behind this, like, we are always evolving as persons, as musicians, songwriters, or even as, you know, a band. And the North Star struck me as a really good overall title, yeah, that reflects some kind of, you know, sense of direction, that helps us kind of stay on course, and even more important on a personal level, that kind of translate to, you know, our inner compass, our inner North Star that kind of guides us towards whatever we want, you know, our passion or purpose. So.
Often the band uses examples or metaphors or stories coming from Norse mythology to kind of bring those themes to life. You've called EINHERJER a Norse heavy metal band.
Yeah.
The term Viking metal is used very quickly. It seems like that label's being slapped now on any band that, you know, even just mentions one thing from Norse mythology. Is that something that you don't like too much, that it's being used so broadly, or are you appreciative that it has become such a popular topic in the last 2-3 decades, that more and more people outside of Scandinavia are discovering these stories and mythologies?
Yeah, I mean, all of that is cool, and I do respect, you know, that there are different schools out there, you know, different schools of Viking metal, so to speak. So and we kind of our school is the old school, you know. We were fairly, you know, early with this whole thing, and we use kind of Bathory, you know, the 12 of the gods, and Hammerheart as a kind of a blueprint on how this is supposed to be, you know, the whole Viking metal thing. And in the beginning, I think that was a really cool term, because it kind of sums up everything.
Yeah.
But down the line, new schools were added to the mix, and I don't know, but for some people, the whole expression, the whole term Viking metal got a bit sour taste, maybe, for some people.
Yeah.
And I'm fine with that too, and I'm still fine with people calling us Viking metal, no problem with that's that's our theme, so that's no problem. But I think that the reason we started calling it Norse heavy metal is actually because that's what it is, and that's more, it's easier for people to understand what is actually what we are doing, because we are basically a heavy metal band. You know, musically in the bottom, that's who we are. That's what it is, you know. And then you have, you know, the black type of voice, you know, the screaming and all that shit I'm doing on top of that. And we have the spice that makes this Norse, you know. And I think that is our influence from like composers like, you know, Eva Grieg, Geir Tveit, and that stuff, and some Norwegian folk music, and that we kind of, you know, adds in there just a tiny bit, you know, just to make it kind of stand out. We are still approaching this the same way as we did in the early days. We are trying to, you know, when you're writing a riff, you're trying to kind of make this kind of a bygone era feel, to make it, you know, to use the big words. And we still try to do that, you know. We still try to make it, you know, to capture that atmosphere. And in the beginning, we also, like you said, used the mythology and those stories a lot, especially, you know, in the 90s, early 2000s. But for the later years, the later albums, especially after the break, I think we are writing lyrics in a very different way. The mythology is still there, but it's not. It's a lot more subtle now, and I think that also the way I write lyrics, it's way more personal, and I kind of just wrap it in a Norse kind of wording, so we still are, you know, within the same genre, so to speak, you know. So yeah, the lyrics are quite different these days compared to back in the day.
And so is, to some extent, the music. Yeah, I mean, on the new album, there's different influences, maybe some that we've not heard before. There are some very groovy elements to some of the new songs. So your influences are clearly beyond that first wave of black metal, or first wave of Norwegian black metal with like the, or Scandinavian black metal, I should say, with Bathory and Hammerheart. You mentioned Metallica already. I can tell clearly from behind you, and I believe also your t-shirt, that you're a big Kiss fan as well.
Absolutely. I mean, the strongest factor there is in music, and that's nostalgia. And that's the reason why, you know, my all-time favorite band, that is Kiss pre-1983, and I will never change. And that is not because of, you know, that is not because of the quality of the music. it is me being a kid, you know, discovering this stuff. And no band will ever exceed that magic, you know, that's impossible. So I also noticed that as I grow older, the whole nostalgia thing is getting stronger, and I think that also reflects our influences, which we now kind of, I wouldn't say dare, but we allow ourselves to let that shine through in music way more than it used to, you know. On a very interesting, fun kind of level, me and Gaia, when we are writing this stuff as well, because we are giving each other kind of, you know, Easter eggs, where we very openly are giving credit or tribute to either a band or a song or whatever that has, you know, meant a lot to us over the years, especially the last two. There are loads of that stuff, you know, of, you know, Rainbow, Kiss, except all that, you know, the classics, you know, the 80s stuff we grew up with.
So it's funny that you say, you know, Kiss before 1983, which for those that are not big Kiss fanatics or just whatever, that is the year that Lick It Up was released.
I love that album, absolutely, but you know, it's everything before that, you know.
Something changed with that album, for sure. the new album is not the only thing that is coming our way. Your debut album, Dragons of the North, is being re-released by Napalm Records as well. It's been 25 years now. Yeah. Fans of the band know that 5 years ago there was the Dragons of the North 20-year anniversary edition as well. What should we expect for this release, especially for fans that have the 20-year anniversary edition?
This is the original, you know, being remastered. So we haven't changed a thing really, except remastering the thing for digital and for vinyl. It has never been remastered or mastered for vinyl before. So this is the first time. It's about time that that the album gets the proper, especially the proper vinyl release. It has been released very quickly on vinyl a couple of years ago, and that was the first time it was released on vinyl, and I think it was only like 200 copies or something, now it's finally done like proper, and we sat down and me and Gara put together the cover stuff, but we only had, for these days, bands are photographing absolutely everything they do. This was the mid-90s. It doesn't exist a photo of anything we did. So we just did our best, and we included a poster based on that old stuff, and we kind of fixed the layout and did the proper, gatefold stuff and fixed that. So it's kind of, it is proper and it looks very good and it sounds good. And we should have been better at taking photos and doing that stuff during the 90s, but we didn't.
I've had the chance to listen to the album. I think it's great. I'm just gonna, I've called it already the black album of EINHERJER. I don't know if you like that comparison or not, but it definitely has that stompy vibe.
In terms of success, I really hope you are right.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, thank you so much for your time. I know that we'll have to wait a little bit longer before we can see you guys play this music live. We're all in the same boat, but one day we'll get that opportunity, and I look forward to that. And I hope you guys can, make it out to Toronto here in Canada. And can't wait to catch up next time for the next release with you guys. So thank you for your time. I appreciate it. And good luck with your black album-like launch cycle.
Excellent. All right. Thank you. Thanks for the interview.
You are awesome for watching this video. Click right here to see more content like it and subscribe to the channel.